giving the community a voice. Haiver FM, How Community Radio.
Welcome to another Heats and Hearts Scotland podcast. Our charity was founded in June 2021 to create, inspire and promote social connections through community arts projects in the Howe and wider North East Fife. We are working with communities impacted by the gradual dismantling of local infrastructure and services, lack of housing, limited transport links, and the integration into our everyday lives of digital technology, contributing to social isolation and loneliness. There has been a lot of research on the effects of loneliness on our mental and physical health. It's seen as one of the biggest health concerns we face. Loneliness is as harmful to our health as smoking 15 cigarettes a day. Heats and Hearts are working alongside local people and groups to build a programme of cultural activities based in the village halls. Governments and organisations such as WHO have researched the evidence supporting the value of the arts to alleviate loneliness. This can take many different forms, everything from singing to painting to writing. There are no age requirements for experiencing these benefits.
Hi, thank you for listening. My name is Ian Harrow and I'm the chair of Heats and Hearts Scotland. We return to more edited highlights from our chum Ben Anderson's shows, which he recorded for us last May during our Haiver FM How Community Radio project. Ben returned to his home village of Newburgh, where he wove interviews with local creative people into his two-hour shows, which were also packed with top-drawer music choices. Unfortunately, music copyright issues mean we cannot include these tunes in this podcast. This episode features Ben talking to local award-winning filmmaker Andy Heathcote, who together with his partner Heike run Trufflepig Films. Their documentary films, including Of Fish and Foe, The Moo Man and Enemy Engagement, have been commended at film festivals across the globe, including Sundance, Berlin and Los Angeles. Andy and Heike also run Buddy Kombucha from Newburgh. Kombucha is a mildly fizzy fermented drink made from sweetened tea and boasts many health benefits.
Next up, we have another interview, and it is with Andy Heathcote, another person from Newburgh, creative mind and also a kombucha maker. So hope you enjoy this interview now. So I'm in the home of Heike Bachelier and Andy Heathcote, her partner, and they are filmmakers and producers for a company called Trufflepig Films, working on projects in Scotland and beyond. They live in Newburgh and recently started producing kombucha from home, turning this into a thriving business. So unfortunately, Heike couldn't join me today. She's feeling a bit under the weather, but I do have Andy here. So Andy, you live and work in the centre of Newburgh, directly next to the steeple where the Wasps Artist Studios is situated. How nourishing do you find the local surroundings for your work as an artist?
It's interesting because this building used to be the old pre-Wasps. This building was Fife Artists Cooperative, and John Strachan, who set the thing up, and his bought this off his son Barney, and it was lovely to move into a house that had been like artist studios, you know, and then we kind of converted it into a film production office, and that was nice. It was a nice legacy the place has got, really. But it's also important to live in a community where people, I think, are creative and care about culture and where those things are important. So
and I mean, Newburgh and the Tay were once thriving salmon fishing places, and there are fishing bothies all along the length of the river, and I understand you and Heike recently made a film about the last salmon fishing centre in Newsan. How can you tell us about the creative process and how challenging it was to make this film?
So, I mean, there used to be literally 1,000 salmon net fishermen in Scotland catching salmon along the coast or in kind of estuaries, and we knew the days were numbered, but we also knew that the politics behind it were a bit not black and white, shall we say. And we also thought a lot of the salmon fishermen weren't being listened to, were getting a bit of a kind of raw deal. And so we went into wanting to make that film to kind of look at this kind of idea there's a lot of environmental questions, for example, or conservation rather than environmental questions. And we wanted to look at those and examine those. What we didn't quite understand going into it was what a minefield it was in terms of, because the environmental group Sea Shepherd got very involved against the salmon fishermen. And, a lot of their reasoning, I didn't, was this thought, well, yeah, that's one side of the argument, but they were very, very good at self-promotion and telling the story. And the salmon fishermen were a bit like caught off guard, shall we say. So we had to try and make a film which reflected both sides of the debate, really, which was challenging, but very enjoyable, because neither of us like one-sided films. We kind of think, we don't like films where you're told what to think. We think the audience should be given an interesting kind of story where they see ups and downs and inside out and kind of make up their own mind. But that can be very difficult to do and very challenging to do. And in that situation, it was an observational documentary we were making. It wasn't like the story of the salmon net fisherman. It was one summer, which turned out to be the last summer for salmon net fishing anywhere in Scotland. It was actually made illegal while we were making the film, quite quickly, quite suddenly, and no one expected that. The salmon fishermen knew there was conservation issues, and what they expected to happen was a tagging scheme would come in, and they'd be licensed to take so many salmon, and that's how they would go forward on a more moderated basis. But suddenly, the Scottish Government said, no, all fishing is going to be stopped. And that happened halfway through filming, and suddenly our kind of film turned upside down. But also what was difficult was a lot of that went on behind closed doors. Government didn't want to go on camera and talk about that. So you had to try and think, okay, how do we tell this story when we can't really get... Also, getting in government departments isn't particularly interesting. What was kind of interesting was being with the fishermen and kind of filming what they did and what their attitudes were, and looking at that ancient way of life, which in Newburgh was important for hundreds of years, and something which was disappearing very fast. So you kind of partly got trying to capture something which you know is disappearing, but you're also trying to tell an interesting story by filming an evolving story. So,
sure.
Yeah, being observational and trying not to be too judgmental was the biggest challenge, probably.
Okay, and remind us of the name of the film and if there's some way that we can watch it online or otherwise.
So the film is called A Fish and Foe. It was actually, BBC Scotland owned the kind of UK rights to it. They commissioned it. So when they come to show it, it's up to them, we haven't got any control of when they show it, but it is also, but we have also got, like, it's on iTunes and it's on Amazon. Yeah, so people can watch it there.
Okay, great. As we all know, lockdown made quite a few people very lonely. What people may not realise is that filmmaking can also be quite lonely. I heard you got a dog to help tackle the loneliness, and I've met her now, lovely Luna. How has that changed your lives?
That's not as simple a story as you might think, because we had a dog before, and her name was Bonnie, and she was lovely husky cross, but she developed epilepsy really bad when she was young, when she was like just under a year old. And so we wanted to do the best we could for her, and we obviously all hoped we would be able to beat the epilepsy, really. But sadly, after 2 years, it got progressively worse, and we lost her. And but we become incredibly attached to her because we had to care for her so much with her quite terrible bouts of epilepsy, not continually, but bouts, which in the end came too much. And and after that, it's like, I thought, I can't have a dog again. But Heike was really missed having a dog and was really attached to the dog. She thought having another dog would be the best way kind of over that, really. And so Luna came along just only about a month or two before lockdown started, really. So having a dog, I think having a dog in lockdown is really fantastic, but a dog comes with demands as well. You know, Luna's a big girl. She's a kind of a Malamute Akita Cross. And, you know, she said we could take dogs for a walk during lockdown because she would have driven us bananas, you know. But no, I mean, dogs are lovely, you know, they're kind of non-human beings, you know, the living beings who you kind of communicate with and build up a relationship with, which is really, really special. And, you know, really, I think it's wonderful, you know. We haven't got kids. I guess that's got a lot to do with the kind of bond you kind of have with an animal that you care for. But it's a very, very special relationship, you know. So, but demanding.
Yeah.
I would always say it's demanding as well.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. So, I mentioned before that you have now a successful kombucha business. So tell me about kombucha. How did that come about? What flavours do you make? And where can we get a hold of some?
Okay. So kombucha is a live fermented drink. So it has live yeast and live bacteria in it. And so it's very good for gut health. We're only just kind of realizing how important good bacteria are to us. And we haven't got as many as we used to have for various reasons, antibiotics, processed foods, chlorine in the water, lots of kind of reasons. And so we need to nourish our gut and our gut bacteria. And all fermented foods are brilliant for that. And kombucha is really, really great for it. And the reason it came to that is because one of our earlier films was called The Moo Man. It was about a farmer who made raw milk because he really believed the live bacteria in raw milk was really, really good for you. And then we made a film, started making a film about a cheesemaker. And she was being prosecuted by Scottish Environmental Health. We thought unfairly because of her raw milk cheese, because he said it was dangerous. And there's a long court case, which eventually on appeal, she won. But both these kind of characters in our films made us really interested in food with live bacteria and fermented foods. So we kind of made our own bread, made kefir and stuff. And I started to make kombucha, which is made from fermented tea. And I just love the taste of it, really. And I thought, this is just so nice. This drink is so nice, and it's so healthy for you. And I think there's a market for it. So I made it personally for about 6 months, and then went to Berlin to do a course in making kombucha, and then started to do farmers markets. So I make it by fermenting a really nice quality tea, which is a lovely Darjeeling from a single estate in India. Ferment that until it's tangy, basically, and then you add a flavour, which is always whole fruit or whole flowers. So we always do lemon and ginger, and we do hibiscus and lime. So it's literally whole lemons. Lemons come from kind of a single estate farm in Spain using crowd farming. So they're lovely lemons. You just zest them, squeeze them, grate some ginger, add it in. So you add that to the fermented tea, and then you put it in this big tank here, which is a one barrel tank next to me, which is chilled. And then when it's ready, good to go, I bottle it in my little bottling machine, which is like a little piece of Victorian steampunk somehow, with all its knobs and levers and stuff. And yeah, bottle it up, and then weekends I do farmers markets. We also the butchers here was great selling it during lockdown, and then Juniper opened up, Juniper sell it. So, but we also do sort of delis in St Andrews and Dundee and Perth. and Methven, but farmers markets is our kind of main outlet, really.
Nice.
And we always do a seasonal flavour, which is just known as beetroot with cardamom. Beetroots come from Jamesfield there, so we always have full flavours. Yeah, and hops as well. So the hops one's like a kind of a beer. It's like a non-alcoholic beer, but genuinely nicer than any non-alcoholic beer. So it's
brilliant.
Yeah.
So you would say the business now has a presence in the community and in a way is also sort of supported by the community?
Yeah, I do think so, yes. I mean, like we I like to reuse our bottles so we can get the bottles back, sterilise them, relabel them and reuse them. But you can tell from the number of bottles that come back that people support it, really. You know, we generally get about 3/4 of our bottles back, which is great. And it's not, you know, obviously it's Newburgh, but like farmers markets have fantastic local support as well. You know, you have regular customers who come back and buy things because they want to support local producers. But the dynamic and the dialogue and the kind of crack that goes on in farmers markets, I really love, you know, I really love the kind of, it's not a sales pitch, it's like a bit of banter between you and your customers who you get to know. And it's really nice. It's a nice way to shop, you know. I really strongly believe food is part of our culture, you know, so to contribute to that, I find really rewarding.
Brilliant. So finally, where can people connect with you and Heike locally and online? And can they drop into the microbrewery? And if you could just mention your socials, etc.
Okay, so our films are on Amazon Prime. So you've got Amazon Prime, the free to watch, the Moo Man and a Fish and Foe. Heike also has a film called Angry Engagement, which is about a Stasi spy and the person, best friend, or the friend he sent to jail, and their reconciliation 20 years later. And we also have a film called Lost World of Mr. Hardy, which is about Hardys, who are a kind of fish and tackle company, 130 years old, based in Alnwick in the north of England, and how they... It's about craftsmanship, basically, and the end of craftsmanship and whether that's important to us or not. So there are four films. They're all on Amazon Prime or iTunes, basically, or on DVD, but people don't really buy DVD anymore. the kombucha, although we have a microbrewery, people are fine to come in and buy some, although it's not always super convenient just because if I'm bottling or something like that. But Juniper is a good place to get it, but people give us a bit of notice. They can get kombucha from us.
Brilliant. And the name of the kombucha company is?
So it's Buddy Kombucha.
Buddy
Kombucha.
Brilliant. Yeah. And finally, I was going to ask you to pick a song to play for the show. And you told me it was going to be a song that was featured at the end of the movie you made about the fishing. So if you could just introduce the song and a little bit about it.
At the end of our film of Fish and Foe, basically when all is lost, the song starts, which is based on Burns's A Man's a Man for All That, because it just kind of rings a poignant note about the world's not always that fair, especially for people who have less political power, if you like. So, yep, A Man's a Man for All That.
Thanks to Ben and Andy. We'll continue to share more of these special edits of Ben's interviews with the fascinating creative people of Newburgh in further episodes. Now, people get to hear about and find podcasts like this one if you share it, rate it, and talk about it. Please follow us on our YouTube channel and Facebook page. Watch out for information on a new project coming soon and find out how you can become involved in making podcasts about creative and fascinating people in your community. And finally, let's play out with a section of that Rabbi Burns song mentioned by Andy, and this is a version performed live by Sheila Wellington at the reconvening of the Scottish Parliament on Saturday 2nd October 2021.
That hangs his head and that the coward slave we pass him by, we dare be pair for all that, for all that and all.
man for all that, for all to know that their tinsel show and all that the honest man though wears a pair is king o' men for all that. Ye see on Birkie called a lord was struts and stairs and all that, though hunders worship at his word, he's but a coof for all that, for all that, and all that, his ribbon star and all.
Haiver FM, How Community Radio, is supported by the Fife Communities Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund through Fife Voluntary Action and the Scottish Government.